stand. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the pathways of righteousness for his name's sake. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadows of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anoints my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. For what then shall we say to this? That if God is for us, who can be against us? For he who did not spare his own son, but gave him up for us all, will he not also give us all things with him? And who shall bring any charge against God's elect? It is God who justifies. Who is to condemn? Is it Christ Jesus who died? Yes, who was raised from the dead, who is at the right hand of God, who intercedes for us? And who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for thy sake we are being killed all the day long. We are regarded as sheep to be slaughtered. No. In all these things, we are more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am sure that neither death, nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come, nor powers, nor height, nor depth, nor anything else in all of creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. For none of us lives to himself. None of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord. And if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For to this end Christ died, and he lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. But if in fact Christ has been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For as by a man came death, by a man has also come the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all people die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive, but each in his own order. For Christ is the first fruits. Then at his coming, those of us who belong to Christ. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. For I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. I greet you in the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus, who is the Christ, with the power of the Holy Spirit. My name is Kevin Mueller. I have the great privilege of serving as senior pastor here at Cascade United Methodist Church. And on behalf of our staff, our clergy team, all of those who call Cascade home, we offer our sincerest condolences to our family, to all of those who have gathered here to celebrate the life of our beloved Amanda Davis. I'm joined on the pulpit by two of my colleagues and two of the former pastors here at Cascade, the Reverend Dr. Walter Kimbrough and also the Reverend Dr. Marvin A. Moss. Friends, it's a tough day. But that's why we call this a celebration of life service. Because even though we have pain in our hearts, tears in our eyes, we know that we serve a God who can indeed give us a peace that surpasses all understanding. That we serve a God that when we know him, we rest with him. And therefore, we can come to celebrate the life of Amanda Davis, who lived well, who loved her God, and who served humanity faithfully. Can we just give God glory in this place to set the atmosphere of a celebration of life service for our beloved Amanda Davis? Come on, can we praise God in this place? For this is the day that the Lord has made, and we shall rejoice, and we shall be glad in it. For I serve a God who will wipe away every tear from our eyes, that mourning shall be no more, that suffering shall be no more, that pain shall be no more, that this is the day. It's still the day that our God has made, and God is still good all the time, and especially in these times, we still gotta call God good. To Melora, I love you. We love you. There is no doubt that we don't feel an ounce of what you feel. This family, you've been surrounded by friends here and those who are watching today around the world. And our hearts are with you. We're going to celebrate her life today, and we're going to follow it by this order of service. We thank God for all of those who have surrounded this family, all of those who have given them comfort during this time. And so the order of service will proceed as printed. I'm going to invite now our director of music, Miss Karen Lowry, to come and lead us in one of the great hymns of the church. Karen, won't you come?
Would you please stand, excluding the family, to hymn number 733, Marching to Zion, that beautiful city of God.
At this time, I want to invite LaRonda Morris and Steve Grierson to the platform, to the pulpit, so that we might have our Old Testament and New Testament scripture reading. And I also want to invite those who are giving reflections this morning, Ambassador Andrew Young and Miss Carolyn Young, Mr. Paul Osman, and Melora Rivera, if you would come as well to the platform so that when your time comes to give reflections, you might proceed as follows. Amen.
Four, answer me when I call to you, my righteous God. Give me relief from my distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. How long will you people turn my glory into shame? How long will you love delusions and seek false gods? Know that the Lord has set apart his faithful servant for himself. The Lord hears when I call to him. Tremble not and do not sin. When you are on your beds, search your hearts and be silent. Offer the sacrifices of the righteous and trust in the Lord. Many, Lord, are asking, who will bring us prosperity? Let the light of your face shine on us. Fill my heart with joy when their grain and new wine abound. In peace, I will lie down and sleep, for you alone, Lord, make me dwell in safety.
Second Timothy chapter 4, verses 6 through 8 and 17 through 18. For I am now ready to be offered, and the time of my departure is at hand. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me that day, and not to me only, but unto all them also that love his appearing. Notwithstanding, the Lord stood with me and strengthened me, that by me the preaching might be fully known, and that all the Gentiles might hear, and I was delivered out of the mouth of the lion, and the Lord shall deliver me from every evil work, and will preserve me until his heavenly kingdom, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen.
To Dr. Muriel, Dr. Kimbrough, and to this family, Melora, Mother, my assignment is to pray, but I ask Pastor Muriel if I could take a moment of personal privilege just to share a few words. I loved Amanda. Amanda was awesome. She had a wit about her, and she was honest with me because when I came to Cascade, she left. And she said I was used to Pastor Kimbrough, a wise man who was able to help me. And I'm thinking, what can this young boy tell me? It's all right to laugh. We're celebrating about life. But she was honest. She was honest in her conversation, one of the few. And she came back. And Pastor Kimber, I don't know if she said you told her to give me another chance or if she just gave me another. I don't care. She came back. Amen, somebody. And we grew together. And I got a chance to not only see her outside, but to see her heart, which so many of us miss so often. And I had to ask her the question, Amanda, how do you do it? And she said, do what? I said, how do you keep showing up and going to the social functions and going to the dinners when you know people are talking about you and just saying stuff that is not even true? And she said, well, you know, everyone's not a Christian. I said, Amanda, I'm talking about the Christians. I got a round trip ticket to Harlem. Amen, somebody. And she said, you have to do you. And she helped me do me. Now I'm the pastor and she's preaching to me. And so we can celebrate because of the beautiful person that she was and prayerfully how she touched each of us. Would you pray with me? Most gracious and eternal God, we've gathered to celebrate the life of our sister Amanda. A true example of one who was caring, giving, forgiving, and loving. And while some may say gone too soon, and while some may ask the question why, Lord, help us to look back over her life and see how she loved her neighbor as herself. Help us to see how she fed the hungry and housed the homeless. Help us, oh God, to see how she cared for the widow, and yea, God, even how she cared for the orphans. So we celebrate because, God, you began a good work in her and you were faithful to complete it. You brought her full circle, God. And we thank you, Lord, that she continued to walk by faith and not by sight. That she walked knowing that the joy of the Lord was her strength. That she prayed for those who despitefully use her, and that, God, she continued to keep her eyes lifted towards the hills, not wondering where her help came from, but knowing that it came from you. So God, bless this family now. Bless them with your peace. Bless them with your joy as they cherish the sweet, precious memories. And yea, God, bless us that when we leave this place, Lord, we'll leave better than we were when we came in because Amanda touched our lives. We thank you. We praise you. We celebrate you now. Give you glory and honor. This is our prayer. And they that loved you and agreed with this prayer said amen, 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 and amen. Come on, let's give God a hand clap of praise.
Amen.
Friends, let us prepare our hearts now to hear reflections from those who are close to Amanda, that we might hear some good things about her life. We invite now our own Ambassador Andrew and Miss Carolyn Young to come, followed by Mr. Paul Osman, and then we will conclude by hearing words from Amanda's daughter, Melora. Amen.
Good morning. My favorite scripture, it comes from 1 Corinthians 13 chapter. Now abide faith, hope, and love. But the greatest of these is love. Amanda Davis was all about love. I guess many of you often wonder, why am I up here? But Amanda and I often talked. We weren't seen a lot together. We were in two clubs together, and she was a wonderful, wonderful person. I tried to always be her best defender and supporter because I loved her. I saw the beauty, but she never saw her beauty. I saw the love. She carried Melora in her heart, and every time I spoke with her, which wasn't a lot, she talked about her beautiful, smart, talented daughter. She was the joy of her life. Her work, her craft, was the joy of her life. And at one point, when it was taken away from her, we prayed together, and I told her, God will make a way. He's with you. He hasn't left you. We have to go through something sometimes. But he will see us through. And Channel 46, I want to thank you. Stand up. Let's give them a hand. Stand up. You saw beneath her hurt and fed her needs. And I want to thank you for that. Her mother, she loved. She loved everybody. She was a hard worker. I was with her in a group, as I told you, I had joined with her. We were chartered members in the Sophisticates. And she served as the charter president and the president for, I think, 22nd or 20th anniversary. Just this April, she did a stellar job. She worked hard. She went to work. She came in. And she said, I have to go home because I have to be to work. I have to get there by 4. But it didn't stop her from working hard. She put her own money in a lot of it. I just want to say, Amanda, God loves you. Melora loves you. Your family loves you. All of us love you. I just hope and I know that there's a way that you know how much you were loved. I think oftentimes she didn't realize it. But God has a way of letting us know it. Thank you.
When I came to Atlanta, Ralph McGill was writing columns. And he wrote 11,000 daily columns trying to guide and lead this city through race relations turmoil. There's no more Ralph McGill, and people don't read the newspapers as much as they used to. But we woke up to hear what Amanda had to say. And we woke up to your news stories. And I want to thank the media who are here, because you're far more important. We loved Amanda because of who she was, and she was one of us from the time she walked on the campus at Clark Atlanta University to the other morning when we heard that she'd gone on home. Now, I wasn't sad. I wasn't sad because the same reason I wasn't sad when Martin Luther King went on home. God knows he deserved it. God knows she had been through many dangers, toils, and snares. And Kenny Leon was just telling me that after one of the incidents that came out in the news, he was worried about it and he came here to church and she was standing there as an usher, ushering people in. And so, bro pastors, we have had some of the most distinguished preachers and pastors in the Methodist Church, starting with Reverend Joseph Lowry and right on through to the present. You all are wonderful pastors, but the Methodist Church understands that we're not here to worship the pastor. We're here because of the people of God who come here to be fed by your word, but also by the smiles and the hugs and the family that you represent in our community. So she, along with you, held our community together. And it's very appropriate that the new, young, beautiful, intelligent, powerful, superwoman mayor who we just elected is here. Would you please stand, Tisha? And you are the glue that holds our church together. You are the spirit of this city. And whether you're in the media, whether you're in the teaching in the school classroom, whether you're singing in the choir, or whether you're working at the grocery store helping people check out baggage, your smiles, your knowing people by name, just makes the city work. Amanda Davis was at the heart of this city. In fact, right now we have to say that she was the heart of this city, at least early in the morning. And all of the dangers, toils, and snares that she had to put up with through the day were all overcome by God's amazing grace, which she received from you in this congregation. Thank you very much. Amanda will be with us. And I know you're going to go back and tell some of those old stories that she told. And yet, even if you don't, there will be Amanda stories that will come to your heads and into your hearts. And Melora, you will always have your mother with you. And when you're doing something that you maybe is kind of questionable, you're going to hear something say, no, child. It never fails. Neither life, nor death, nor angels, nor principalities, nor things present, nor things to come. Nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. We know that love. And we know that death does not separate us from that love of Amanda.
Good morning. First of all, I'd like to thank the people on the program committee for having me follow the ambassador and Mrs. Young. You know, I've learned that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but people will never forget how you made them feel. Words penned by Maya Angelou seem so appropriate today with Amanda. It's how she made us all feel. Today we are here to celebrate the life of our friend, our colleague, and angel of God, Amanda Davis. Like many of you, I've spent hours crying, hurt, and confused, asking why and why now. Then a dear friend of mine said, "Paul, when you have the pleasure of serving the highest of all powers, when the boss comes calling, there is no such thing as just a minute." Amanda Davis was truly called. You know, crazy when you think of the profession that she chose and a lot of us chose, there's always that element of time. How much time do you need for that story? How much time do I get for weather? Which, by the way, producers, is never enough. The time is 6 o'clock. It's time for the news. I'll see you next time. I don't have the time. I need more time. I wish I had taken the time. Amanda Davis made time. Her passion for life, her journey, her love of Christ and family and friends were at the pinnacle which drove her very soul. She made time to get to know people, some who were lucky enough to become and stay cherished friends despite what was going on in her life. And although Amanda was a private person and truly introverted, her outward generosity was simply amazing. And despite any personal struggles going on in her life, she did take time to smell the roses. You know, many of us will reflect on the last time we saw or talked with Amanda. I remember the last time I worked with Amanda. Recently, I was promoted to evenings, and so our schedules didn't match up, but it did on our station's coverage of the solar eclipse. Something happened. I wasn't getting the cues in my ears. Of course, you know the talent is never wrong. I said something to the producer, like, "Listen, if you want me in place and you want me there at a certain time, you need to give me better cues." And without missing a beat, Amanda said, "Man, listen to the chief taking charge, making noise, taking names." Always followed by that infectious laugh that she had. You know, Amanda and I shared many of those moments. As you might remember, we were the original host of Good Day Atlanta. You know, that was an experience that really brought us so close together. You know, we both were amazed and thrilled at the success of that show that revolved around two people getting to know the community around us. It was a bond that would tie us together forever. It was also a time I watched a single mom bring her beautiful daughter, Melora, to work every morning to sleep in the green room until mom did everything and did her job until it was time for her to go to school. I watched, as many of us did, her rise to stardom in a community she served so well, not knowing that in the process, she was inspiring journalists of tomorrow. You know, she loved hosting the MLK services, finding homes for foster kids through Wednesday's Child, and honoring those unsung heroes in CBS 46's Surprise Squad. And everything Amanda did had an impact on her. You know, I was really impressed when I read all about the distinguished local and national celebrities paying homage to this remarkable woman on social media. What to me was more impressive were all those selfies I saw posted on social media of the many followers and admirers who Amanda touched for that simple click in time. There's that word again, time. These people, names who most of us will never know, cherished their brief moment with Amanda. But looking at those pictures on social media, it looked like Amanda was having as much fun as they were. Once again, she made the time. And now that Amanda has answered the call from the Lord, we know beyond a shadow of a doubt that she is standing before God and hearing those words from the Gospel of Matthew, "Well done, you are a good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a little, I will put you in charge of much. Come celebrate with me." Amanda is celebrating her time now in eternal celebration. But we can celebrate with her and for her and continue to love her. And when I see her again and when it's my time to answer the call, I will say, "Amanda, I love you." Thank you.
Many people have shared words of comfort with me, offered their prayers, and told stories of how much my mom impacted their lives. But as proud as I have always been of her work and her philanthropy, nothing compares to the love she's given to me. My mother and I are both only children. She and I have been best friends since the moment I was born. My middle name came from her. It's Joy. Everyone told her I was going to be a boy. But when I entered the world, she, my father, and the doctor were surprised to see I was a girl. To put it plainly, she was relieved. Like most first-time parents, she was anxious. She was worried about how to provide while also following her dreams. But with a village of strong women at her side, she knew we'd be okay. And we were. Through everything. Through every celebration. Through every difficult moment. I was always right there with her. And she with me. I was always her plus one. It's how I met so many of you over the years, as our guests for some event. Everything from Wednesday's child shoots to the mayor's mass ball, my mom took me everywhere. And like the graceful and classy woman she was, she expected me to behave accordingly. I am so incredibly close to her friends because she always let me sit at the table. She always treated me like a fully formed person and wanted me to see what it takes to live so unapologetically, so fiercely, so independently, and so righteously. Exceptional is a word that comes to mind, but that doesn't even begin to describe how amazing my mother was. I won't ever stop missing her, her laughter, her joy, or her smile. And I hope none of you do either. Thank you.
Those members of the family who have been designated to come and to share, and the lighting of the candle of remembrance would come. This is a high moment, certainly in the life of, in the experience, the context of every service of celebration held in this congregation. When a member of this congregation makes his or her transition from life temporary to life eternal, we light the candle of remembrance. And it's most significant to note that the word light is very central and significant, because we're reminded how in the first book of the Bible, in Genesis, God spoke into existence light. Remember how God said, let there be what? And there was what? Light. And then God declared that the light was good. And then in the first book of the New Testament, in Matthew. Jesus spoke power into the life of his disciples. You remember how he declared, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid. And no one takes a light and hides it, but rather puts it on a stand so that it's held high to the end that men, women, boys and girls may see it and to know that there is something significant about the light." And we light today this candle of remembrance. And I challenge and charge you today, as you light it, that you will remember Amanda's life, her love, and her legacy. And on this day, as you light it, be reminded, on All Saints Sunday, the first Sunday in November, we will again light a candle in remembrance. And I want to just place the hearts of everyone here. I want you to remember the 17th day of October. Lisa, the birthday of Amanda. Wherever you are, consider lighting a candle of remembrance. And then on December the 27th, just consider lighting another candle of remembrance. To the end that we will never forget Amanda's life and her, I'm testing you now, and her love and her legacy. Her what? And her. I think you all got it now. So won't you light the candle of remembrance? In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, so be it. Amen.
Good morning. To Malora, Mrs. Davis, the family, friends of my sister in Christ, Amanda. We knew her well here at Cascade, as you've heard already mentioned. And that is why this song was chosen, because she helped, she taught, she showed us, she gave of herself in so many ways, in so many ways. May the words of this song bring comfort to the family. If I can help somebody
as I pass along. If I can teach somebody with a word or a song, if I can show somebody that he's traveling wrong, then my living shall not be in vain. Can do my duty as a Christian ought. If I can spread the message that the master taught, then my living shall not be in vain.
Hallelujah.
Won't you pray with me? God of our weary ears, God of our silent tears, Lord, you brought us thus far along the way. So God, who by thy might lead us into the light, keep us forever in the path, we pray. Amen. Friends, on the morning of August 19th, 2017, Amanda sent me a text message that I want to share with you this morning. On a Saturday morning, she texted me and she said, "Good morning, Pastor. It's a blessing to see you settling into your new role at our beloved Cascade. I'm hoping you can help me with a scripture if it's not too much trouble. In one of your lessons, you talked about God getting our attention suddenly. That resonated with me, and I use it as my testimony. But I've never known the scripture. Please help me. Thank you, Amanda." I sent her a message back asking, "Amanda, how long ago did I preach that message?" She said, "Oh, it was 4 years ago." So I'm thinking in my mind, how am I going to remember a sermon that I preached 4 years ago? But thank God for the cloud. Amen. So I went back in the cloud and I recalled that sermon. It was on a Wednesday evening. She was sitting the third row right here in the middle section. And that night I preached a sermon titled, "How God Handles Hopelessness." And the scripture that Amanda was referring to was one of the great hymns that David wrote, Psalm 40. And today I want to share with you some words that I hope will provide some comfort to us all from the scripture that Amanda used as her testimony. Psalm 40, verses 1 through 3. Hear the words of King David, who said, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined to me, and he heard my cry. He also brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock and established my steps. He has put a new song in my mouth, a praise to our God. Many will see it and fear, and they will trust in the Lord." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. At the funeral of Atlanta's son, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., his loving wife, Coretta, had an excerpt of her husband's prophetic sermon titled "Drum Major Instinct" played for those in attendance to hear. Echoing through the church, you could hear Dr. King proclaim how it was that he wanted to be remembered. He did not want to be remembered for his temporal accomplishments like degrees and awards or fame. But rather, Dr. King ultimately wanted to be remembered as a drum major for justice, who loved people and worked to love and serve all of humanity. You see, friends, Dr. King preached his own eulogy, not just with words, but through the life that he lived, the change that he enabled, the struggles he overcame, and the millions of people that he inspired. And from the showing here today, it is evident that Amanda Davis also lived her eulogy through the lives that she touched, through the struggles she overcame, and the millions of people around the world that she inspired. You see, she was a glowing representation of what St. Augustine described as love being the beauty of the soul. And she loved many people, and many people loved her. She loved her daughter, Melora. And as you get to know Melora, you will see how much like Amanda she really is. She loved her family. She loved her church. She loved her colleagues with whom she shared the air for over 30 years. She loved her friends. And y'all know Amanda loved to have fun. She was an exquisite social butterfly who never had a problem going live on Facebook to show all of her followers her social moments and even her good dance moves. She will forever be known as a trailblazer in the news and media industry who received numerous awards and accolades. And before even this hashtag existence, she will be known as the epitome of black girl magic. And with all of her success, Amanda's life, I believe, teaches us so much more about our own lives. Something different, something prophetic, something purposeful. And perhaps it isn't far-fetched in view of Amanda's life to even declare her as a 21st century prophetess who happened to be a news anchor. Because like many prophets in the Bible and in times past, her life proclaimed how God can take pain and create promise. How God can turn sorrow into joy. How God can lift a testimony out of any test that we go through. Which is why Amanda, I believe, resonated with Psalm 40, whose author, King David, had a PhD in the subjects of pain and sorrow and tribulation. But he also learned that God is a God who is near to the brokenhearted, that he saves those whose spirits have been crushed. And I want to be real this morning and simply to acknowledge the depth of our pain. We hurting, y'all. This is a painful experience. Many of us sit in these pews today or watching around the world, and our hearts have sank within us. Because pain, as C.S. Lewis says, has a way of removing the veil. It makes tears flow, and it causes us to reflect on the importance of making every day count. And every day we rise, God pulls out his celestial pen and paper, and he begins to write another verse to the song of our lives. And Psalm 40, beloved, is a song about the pits of life. It is a psalm that creates for us a reflective opportunity on the reality of life. And that is, if we live long enough, as Granddaddy used to say, every one of us at some point will find ourselves in some kind of pit. A pit of an unyielding place of egregious struggle and pain. And friends, pits don't discriminate. The wealthy experience pits and the poor experience pits. The religious have pits and the unreligious have pits. White people have pits and black people have pits. Politicians have pits and preachers have pits. And even if you're the prettiest or most handsome in here today, even at some point you will experience a pit in life. Do I have a witness in this place? And there are public pits and there are private pits. But regardless of the pit that you find yourself in, never be so self-righteous as to look over and judge someone else's pit, because theirs may be more public than yours is, because at the end of the day, I've come to find out that a pit is a pit. A public pit is a public pit. A private pit is a public, is a private pit. A pit is a pit. Has anybody ever been through any pits in here? I know we in church, y'all. Has anybody ever been through any pits in this place? Now that we have established protocol in here, that nobody's pit is better than any other person's pit. In a three-part powerful interview segment, Amanda Davis acknowledged her own personal pit. And in her own words, she declared, "Someone would hear my cry for help. And I hurt, and I needed to escape." Yeah, yeah.
And you see, we don't always hear the cry for help because we are humans, we are fallible. And sometimes our worlds are so busy that we rarely hear the cry of other people from their own pit. But let me tell you about one who always hears. That my God always hears our cries for help. And in the modified words of Tim Keller, you don't really know God is all you need until God is all you have. Somebody can testify to that. You didn't know that you needed God until friends walked away. Family members turned their back. Colleagues talked about you, but you didn't know where to go but to turn to God. And when friends are few and life gets real, God is the only one who really understands your pit. And she declared, our beloved Amanda, the good news. She declared, as David did, that God also brought me out of this horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and he set my feet upon a rock, and he established my steps. Because friends, once you have gone through and come out of painful moments in life, God has a unique way of reestablishing your faith and reinvigorating your joy. And in the latter days of Amanda's life, God established some new steps for her at CBS 46. And though we didn't know it, and perhaps even she didn't know it, God was ordering Amanda's steps in her last days in a way that would touch and transform the lives of millions of people around the world. For our steps in this life are ordered by God. And you know what? She was happy. She had joy. And when she made her return to CBS 46, and obviously CBS was elated to have Amanda back, because driving through any part of the city, there were billboards everywhere. CBS, y'all must have spent y'all's whole budget on billboards for Amanda. You were that excited. And the billboards read like this: Amanda is back. Because you got to realize that your setback is simply God's ability to bring a comeback in your life. When you really realize whose you are, you don't trip over your past experiences, because God can create something out of anything that you go through. I know I'm a preacher. I got to preach right about here. Can y'all allow me this? And my God works together all things for the good of them who love him and for those who are called according to his purpose. Amanda is back. And she loved it. She loved being back on the air. She loved being able to touch people's lives in a unique way. And in fact, one day I passed a billboard as I was driving into the office, and this billboard was above some large trees. And so I decided I was going to take a picture of it. So I took a picture and I sent it to Amanda, and she wrote me back these words. She says, Pastor, I'm so humbled to be back. But Pastor, you think you could pull over and trim the tree limbs in front of my picture? LOL, just kidding, just kidding. That's just how Amanda was. And when she was back, she was back. And the Lord put a new song in her mouth. And this song was not a blues-like genre that declares the thrill is gone. No, it is a song of praise to our God, an anthem of endurance and deliverance. This was Amanda's song. Friends, in the coming hours and days, news outlets across the country will cover this day. It will become a trend on social media. Stories will be told, and an extraordinary life will be celebrated nationwide on today. But like any news cycle, it would pass, and you know, that's all right. We understand that. But today, I want everybody in here and watching around the world to get the story of Amanda Davis's life correct. If Amanda were standing here, I believe that she would say, tell the people that Amanda could interview presidents. She could hang with celebrities in the highest echelon of society one day, and the very next day sit and have a normal conversation with any average Joe, because she did not worship her platform, but she knew it was a gift to be used to better the lives of millions around the world. Amanda probably wouldn't want you to spend too much time mentioning how many Emmys she won, even though that's important, how many degrees she attained, or the numerous accolades that she received. I imagine that Amanda would want you to say these words. Tell them about how many children who now live in loving homes because of Wednesday's child. Tell them how I overcame racism and sexism during my career and I pressed on anyhow. Tell them that I paved the way for many young journalists of color who you see on the air reporting today. Tell them that I broke down barriers of division in a segregated society by the relationships that I built with all of my white colleagues. Tell them that I loved people of all races and all faith traditions, no matter where they're from or who they love or who they worship, I love them. Tell them that I love my church and I love to serve at my church. Tell them that I love my daughter and I'm rooting for her success. Tell them that I gave my all, and guess what? I went out on top. And just in case you can't remember anything that I just said, tell them that I fought the good fight, that I finished my course, that I kept the faith, and now there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness that only my God can give me. Tell them that story. And then I want you to also tell them that this is a song that I'm singing in the gates of eternity. Tell them if I can help somebody as I pass along, if I can cheer somebody with a word or a song, if I can show somebody who's traveling wrong, then my living will not be in vain. And my living will not be in vain. And Amanda would also sing this, for this is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. This is my story. This is my song, praising my Savior all the day long. Let's remember Amanda by telling our story of how we made it over. For my soul looks back and it thanks God that I made it over. In the name of the Father, Son, and of the Holy Spirit, let's celebrate a life that is lived well for the glory of our God. In Jesus' name, amen.
To welcome Brittany Craig and Naomi Bryn Wilson as they minister to us in song, His Eye is on the Sparrow and the Lord's Prayer.
Why should I feel discouraged? And why shouldn't the shadows come? And why should my heart feel lonely and long for my heavenly home? When Jesus
that he watches me. I sing because I'm happy. Oh, I sing because I'm free. His eye is on the sparrow, and I know that he watches, and I know that he watches, and I know, I know he watches me. Thank you.
Temptation, but deliver us from all evil. Oh,
Amen. Would you join me in giving a round of applause for all of those who have led music for today and all of those who blessed us in song? Thank you so much for using the gifts. At this time, we have several acknowledgments that I just want to briefly make. I also want to certainly recognize the elected officials who are among us. It's a testament to this family how much Amanda is loved. We have several proclamations here. I'm not going to read them all, but I am going to acknowledge them. I also want to, first of all, acknowledge the presence, as Ambassador Young already did it, but I want to say a special welcome to our new mayor, Mayor Keisha Lance Bottoms. Mayor Bottoms, we thank God for you. Your mother, so grateful for you being here with us. Also want to recognize the presence of Congressman John Lewis. Congressman Lewis, will you please stand if you would? God bless you, sir. And certainly, Ambassador Young, we thank God for you and praise God for you and your leadership. Are there any other elected officials here in the congregation this afternoon? I can't see. Congressman Hank Johnson. Amen. God bless you. I didn't see you over there. Amen. Former Mayor Bill Campbell. Thought I saw Bill. Yeah, here he is. Bless you, Bill. Now, that's a long way to see back there. Amen. Judge Belinda Edwards. Belinda Edwards. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for being here. Pam Dickens. Pam? Is she? Pam. God bless you. This is a proclamation sent from Michael Julian Bond of the City of Atlanta. And we will certainly give this to the family. And we thank you, Michael, and certainly to our city council for sending in this proclamation. Also want to acknowledge proclamation given by our own mayor, Keisha Lance Bottoms of the City of Atlanta, on behalf of the people of Atlanta. We remember Amanda Davis, veteran Atlanta news anchor. We also have a proclamation from the National Association of Black Journalists, from Sarah Glover, president, with heartfelt sympathies to the family of Amanda Davis. And this proclamation given on behalf of the 100 Black Men of Atlanta Incorporated, a proclamation in loving memory of Amanda Marie Davis. And I think the 100 is here, seated. Here they are. Amen. This is from the family. Weeping may endure for a night, but we know that joy cometh in the morning. We hasten to extend our sincerest thanks to so many friends and family who brought food, flowers, and other articles, while others gave time, energy, shared a laugh, or gave gifts. Still others offered fervent prayers and uplifting songs. We are so grateful for every expression of love. Please accept our thanksgiving from the bottom of our hearts. We cannot find words adequate to express our gratitude. May the Lord bless you all the days of your lives. This is from the family. Friends, as we prepare our hearts to leave this place, Amanda goes with us. We go with one another. After the services have concluded, the family will step outside into Grand Hall for a moment to greet you, to share some time of fellowship, after which they will proceed downstairs to a private reception for them. And I just want to encourage you in the days ahead, because sometimes after things like this happen, we are very fleeting. Keep Amanda in your thoughts. Keep her family in your prayers. 3 months from now, reach out. Let them know you're praying for them. Because we know that heaven has gained a great jewel. Hallelujah. We now turn the service over into the hands of our funeral directors. We invite everyone to stand, excluding the family.
If you want.